I'm Mike Costello, and I'm with the Reverend Iris Freelander, and today we'd like to spend a few moments talking to you about spiritual healing. All of us are interested in health, and all of us are interested in healing our diseases, both physical and mental and spiritual. And so today we're going to talk about some different and new concepts in spiritual healing. And Iris, why don't we start by talking about a program that you're going to be giving at the church?
Good. Well, I really look forward to presenting that workshop at the church. And it is going to be why people don't heal. And the reason people don't heal is because they don't put their minds to it very often, or they are fulfilling a purpose in life. Sometimes they're fulfilling a purpose in life, which is a very wonderfully unique way of serving humanity. So we can never be judgmental on why people don't heal, and we can not even be judgmental about ourselves. But we can expect to be healed, and very often we will be.
Mm-hmm. And so many people do receive healings, but others don't, and that seems to be a question in people's minds. And I think so many people believe that it either validates or negates faith, and that's not the situation at all.
No, it's too bad people feel that way, but that's just the way our minds run. We think if one cake doesn't come out right, they're all not going to come out right, and that's not true, you know. Everything varies in life, and healing varies in life, and we might be healed, have a spiritual healing from one disease, and then be killed through some other disease or through some accident. And we know people who have come back from wars, for example, and they've gone through heinous wars, and yet they come home and are killed in an automobile accident. So only God knows when people are going to go. I think that we set our time to die before we come in. We set up a time of how long we're going to live and what we're going to accomplish in life. And overall, we have an outline of what we're going to do. And then when our time comes to go, we go. Mm-hmm. But we can stay healthy more or less as long as we do live. And we certainly need to try and stay healthy. And one way is through our attitude. The main thing on staying healthy or regaining our health when we've lost our health is to just have the attitude of hopefulness and encouragement and to not have a negative attitude.
Yeah, the power of the mind to influence us in our healing process is tremendous, isn't it?
Yes, it is. And it can heal us or it can harm us. And it is that powerful. And Dr. Carolyn Mace is a lady, she has her work that she does with Dr. Norm Shealy she's a medical clairvoyant or medical intuitive, and she is able to just tune in to someone either by phone or in person and tell them what's wrong in their bodies. And she can see totally. And she says that's the only way she uses her clairvoyant vision. But she says we're all intuitive and we should each develop our intuitive capacity. And I believe that's true. Mm-hmm. I started testing my intuition when I was about 18, 20 years old. And I was taught at that time, when you receive a letter, before looking to see who it's from, hold it in your hand and see if you can tell who it's from. If the doorbell rings, decide who's there. When the phone rings, decide who's there. So work with your intuition and find out. And now, this many years later, Dr. Mace is saying the same thing, that we all have the capability, we just have to perfect it. And I think that that's true, and I know that you do too.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, definitely, and that ability to draw upon that resource is tremendously important.
Yes, it's just like the power of prayer is so potent that very often those of us who work in the ministerial field shortchange that power, because we can never say strong enough words of how potent power can be. And we know that we can pray for others and they'll be healed. She gives an example of a sister. She said she received all her education up until she was 29 years old at Catholic schools. And there was a sister who was dying of a brain tumor. And the doctors said they couldn't do anything more for her, that she was going to die and very soon. So the sisters took over and they prayed for her throughout the night without ceasing. And a lot of them prayed for her without ceasing. And the next morning her tumor was gone and the doctors couldn't believe it. And we know of other spiritual healings where people have healed just in that same way. But it seems miraculous to us in a sense, but it isn't, because we know and we teach that with God all things are possible.
Mm-hmm. Now, the concept of a medical intuitive or clairvoyant, for the benefit of people who don't understand the concept even of clairvoyance or spiritual intuition, mm-hmm. can we talk a little bit about that?
Yes. As you know, it is just when people are able to see clairvoyantly, they can see. For example, they just see what seems to be reality. We say we create our own reality, mm-hmm. and indeed we do. But the question is, what reality are we creating? A clairvoyant can see what reality one has created inside oneself, or what we brought through from another life. And she says something that I have been saying for quite a long time and agree with her 100%, that past life therapy is not of particular value. It's not of particular importance in our lives, except occasionally. Mostly, we have to do what you teach so brilliantly, live in the now. Mm-hmm. So if we're living in the now, we're not looking into the past all the time. Because when we put our energy into the past, we're doing just that. We're putting our energy into the past. And so we're not able then to put all our energies into the here and now. And when we do that, wherever we put our energies, that's where part of our power goes.
And from a spiritual standpoint, whenever we spend time in the past or we spend time in the future and we're not in this present moment, then we're not dealing with the reality of what life is for us in this moment.
Exactly.
And when it comes to our health, if we are sick or if we have an illness or a disease, we have that illness or disease. And stepping out of that situation and going back in time, so many people are preoccupied with, why do I have it?
Yes.
What did I do?
Yes.
Where did I bring it? I bring it with me? And of course, there are all kinds of answers to those mm-hmm. questions. But if we dwell upon those questions and don't deal with the reality of the illness and the disease, then we're really shortchanging ourselves.
Exactly. And that's what we're doing exactly, shortchanging ourselves. Because we're putting our energy where it's not doing us any good. Mm-hmm. We're putting our energy where it's detracting from our health. And she uses the example of having 100 circuits coming through your head. And this is what she sees as she is clairvoyant. She sees these circuits coming through your crown chakra. As you know, but I'll say for our audience, of those who don't know, we have 7 major chakras, and they are force centers in our body located over the 7 major endocrine glands. And you can feel that energy. If anyone wants to test, they can just put their hand over their heart chakra or their solar plexus chakra. And those are seemingly people can feel those energies more fully, mm-hmm. and they can feel that energy of their own bodies or of someone else's body. So we have the spiritual centers at the top, in the center of the head, and then the throat chakra at the throat, and the crown, the heart chakra at the thymus gland, and then so and so forth. And as she looks at people, she can see the circuits of energy going to those 7 major chakras, and she can see where their energy is going and which chakra the energy is going out of. Now, with very little practice, we can see that ourselves. We can sense where our energy is going. And she says the root chakra at the base of the spine is the tribal energy chakra. That has to do with our tribe, our family. The people who are important in our lives as family. And if we're sending negative energy out to those people, then we're sending our energy out in that way. And she says, let's say we have 100 circuits in all, 100%. So if you're very angry at someone and you're very upset with someone, then you send out, let's say, 40% of your energy. And that's a logical amount. If we are very angry, if we're exhibiting a lot of emotion. So then let's say we're thinking of our past and we're thinking, I wish I hadn't done such and such 10 years ago. So we're sending another 10% of our energy to that. So then we're thinking of other factors in our lives and we're thinking that we wish we hadn't, or we're sending energy out to them. However we send our energy out, then that's the way it goes. And if we put a negative context to that, then it goes out in a negative way. Mm-hmm. And if we put a positive, like, I know that God can heal me, you do affirmations a great deal at the church, and that's a wonderful thing. We can affirm positive factors about our health, about our lives, and it gives that factor energy. So it's up to us if we want to send our energy out in a negative way or if we want to send it out in a positive way. If we want to collect energy within ourselves and be strong within ourselves, then we can do that. It's up to us. We do indeed create our own reality. But again, we need to ask ourselves, what reality am I creating? Mm-hmm.
Very, very important. And I think those of us that are involved in New Thought, our fellowship, we is a New Thought Christian church. And in New Thought, we have so many wonderful teachings that help us to understand the power of the mind and divine healing and spiritual reality. But we also have some kinds of ideas and thoughts that have been cultivated and have been nurtured over a long period of time in the New Thought movement. And part of that has to do with the fact that we are able to create our own reality. And of course, we do know that we do create our reality and we live in our minds. But so many people have taken that a step further and have come to believe that they can manifest or create anything that they wish. And of course, there are a lot of things that we do manifest and create, and we do have control totally over the way that we think and the way that our mind operates. But so often when we look at people who are ill, for instance, or have diseases of different kinds, in New Thought or in traditional churches, we'll see people who will say, well, that was caused by this or that. Yeah. And that seem to be very people who are very interested in kind of pontificating about why it is he or she is sick or what it is that they've done to draw this to themselves. And we get into this kind of judging and we get into this issue of wanting to understand the source and the cause, when in fact what we need to focus on is the person and the circumstance.
Yes.
If someone has cancer, they're a sick person who has cancer, and of course we want to send them healing and we want to send them strength and we want to do a variety of things to help them to heal and to realize the best quality of life. But the best quality of life does not always have to do with sitting down with them and saying, you have this cancer because of the bitterness in your heart and or any number of other causes. And I think we need to be very cautious about that.
Yes, and we have, and people have to see it for themselves. Dr. Mace gives a prime example of that, of what you were just saying. There was a lady who came to Dr. Norm Shealy's workshop that was supposed to be a one-week workshop, and that lady came on a stretcher, and she was practically unable to move. She was so miserable that they had to have her pillows a certain way, and her body was just really, she could not ever be comfortable. She came to that workshop, and the people prayed for her, and she prayed for herself. And Dr. Shealy pointed out to them how she was creating her own illness. And the way he presented how she created her own illness, she could see in her life, and you'd have to be clairvoyant to see in her life, to see what happened, but how her life had gone so that she had indeed created that illness for herself. So she went into a deep coma-like circumstance, and he thought she had died because she seemed near death when she arrived there at that workshop. And when she came out of that, after about 15 minutes, she stood up. Now, mind you, she had just been so incapacitated. Mm-hmm. She stood up and said, thank you very much. I thank all of you for your prayers, but I'm going home. And she thanked them and walked out and went home. Now, this wasn't the first day of the workshop, and she had been there for a time, but she didn't stay the full time. So 6 months later, she picked Dr. Shealy up at the airport here in L.A. She was from L.A. And so she said, she thanked him again once more for her healing, and she said, I saw what I needed to do, and I saw what I was doing wrong in my life. Her husband had been married for many years, and she and her husband had two grown sons. Her husband had been unfaithful to her with one of her bridesmaids on their wedding day. He had been unfaithful to her all their married life. People kept telling her, you need to leave that man. And people kept prompting her what she needed to do. Well, she loved her husband, and she wanted to stay married to him. And it came to her while she was at his workshop, it wouldn't matter who her husband had been married to, that man would not have been faithful to anyone. And if she loved him, then she has to accept that she wants to stay married to him. And she has to stop letting other people put ideas into her head that she's not doing the right thing in staying with him. So she made up her mind, took back her power, came home, and grew healthy. So within a very short time, she had totally regained her health. And that was something that points out how we do create our own reality. And just that in that very short time at his workshop, she was able to see her life and what she was doing wrong and make decisions. Mm-hmm. So we have to make strong decisions for ourselves and then stand back of those decisions. And that's what she did.
And those decisions are made in our mind.
Yes.
I mean, they begin in the mind.
Exactly. Mm-hmm. She realized that at his workshop. And I think that's very interesting that when we do lectures, when we do our discussions, when we do our program here, when we speak at the church, we never know how we're touching another person because we say what we're prompted to say, but it resonates to each different person in a different way. And this is why I know at the church very often on Sunday morning, so many people will say, well, Pastor Mike or Dr. Costello were speaking exactly to me, was speaking totally to me, mm-hmm. because that's the way it seems. Because you're saying what you're impressed to say, but they're taking it from their own personal level. And isn't it wonderful that it works that way?
It is. It's magnificent. And of course, I've seen it and you've seen it for years working in churches and understanding that that's the way the dynamic operates. When in fact, very often a message that's created, and of course, many times the messages that I bring, I have no earthly idea that they apply to anybody except that essentially we're bringing spiritual truth and sharing information. And yet they do speak to people at their point of need. And that has to do with the fact that people do have a point of need, and then when that point of need is met by a like circumstance or situation or a person that shares a word or an encouragement, that connection is made. And as you said, it resonates at that rate. And then that person has their particular need met. And I'm sure it happens always when we have the dynamic of a number of people listening to one speaker. Mm-hmm.
Yes, that's true. And I think sometimes a speaker is prompted by the guardian angel of another person to say certain things that they need to say or prompted to think along those lines. And then they say it, the speaker then says it from their own frame of reference. But I know that those on the inner planes of being work with us so fully and so magnificently that we would all be amazed if we knew to what extent they do.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Very true. Now, the concepts that Dr. Mays, or she is Dr. Mays?
Yes.
Yeah. Promotes really relate to some of the use of the chakras in a different way than...
Yes. Well, we use our chakras whether or not we realize we are. It's just like the people who come to hear you speak are living whatever it is they're living, and then everyone thinks that you're speaking directly to them. Well, our chakras each work in their own way, and they work according to how we direct them with our thoughts, just as your presentation on Sunday morning changes all these different people's lives because they're relating to it personally. Well, each chakra relates to whatever energy we're putting into it. So the root chakra would be the tribe, the family, and anything pertaining to the family. And then the next chakra, the spleen chakra, I call it the spleen chakra, the second chakra, would relate to sex, money, and power. Anything pertaining to sex, money, or power in our lives would relate to that chakra. And then with the third chakra, it's our image, our self-image, and how we see ourselves, and how we hope that others see us, but it's really how we see ourselves and our self-image, basically. And then the fourth chakra is the heart, and it resonates to the three lower physically oriented chakras, and also to the three higher spiritually oriented chakras. Now, that's what we teach in our church. And so she takes it, though, a step farther and shows us how they work in that way. And so if we have a problem, so many people have family problems. And so if they're having a family problem, their energy stays stuck in their first chakra if they don't bring it up to other centers. And so then they send all that energy out from that chakra and they never get to work from their spiritual centers. So we can consciously bring back our power by starting with the root chakra and feeling to see, where's my energy going? Is it going out that root chakra, the first chakra? If it is, then bring it up to the second chakra, then bring it up to the third, which is our own self-image, and then to the heart chakra and send the love out, mm-hmm. and then to the throat chakra, which is the will. And the throat chakra, the will, is the one that creates so many problems for us because we use our will, not my will, but thine be done, O God, in me and through me, is a good mantra for us to live by. But very often, we just think what we want mm-hmm. instead of what's good for the whole or what's...
And that has to do with our health as well.
Yes.
Because we always want to be healthy.
Yes.
And we, of course, are always healthy. But our physical bodies may, from time to time, not be healthy.
That's
and
right.
may be visited by disease or illness. And in that process, we don't know. We don't know why that is. But we do know that everything is working together for good and that out of that, some very wonderful and positive things may very well come.
Yes, and I think that we can all look at other people and see, but mostly what's going on in their lives. But we can really only look at our own lives and see what we're doing that we need to change. And if our audience, for example, want to change their healing ways of healing themselves, then they can just remember those basic facts. Because we've been teaching about the chakras now more than 30 years, and it all goes together. Mm-hmm. It all works together for the good.
Now, you were speaking a few minutes ago about people examining their own physical condition and aligning that with the reality of their chakras or the condition of their chakras. And again, because so many people don't understand the very fundamental basics of what we're talking about, how would someone begin this process?
Well, they can feel the energy in their bodies, and they can just feel that if they've never heard the word chakra before and never have studied it in any way, they can feel that energy down in the genital area for the root chakra, and in the lower hips, and they can actually feel the energy there. And if they're not living according to their highest good, then they'll develop pain in that area. And the same would be true in the second chakra, sex, money, or power. The pain would be in the lower back and in the higher up in the body than the base chakra, the root chakra would be. And then they can feel the energy going out or feel the energy in their bodies and see where that's going. Another thing, we are all intuitive. Dr. Mace teaches that we're all intuitive. Well, I believe that we are too. So we can just ask, because our guardian angel is always there to help us. Those on the inner planes are always there to help us. And we have our own high self that we don't access so often. We stay in our lower chakras instead of going to the higher ones. Mm-hmm. And when we think in a spiritual way, we're thinking from the spiritual chakras. And so we just need to ask, where am I losing my energy? And feel where the energy is going out, and you can feel it going out. Mm-hmm. And then consciously bring the energy from the first chakra to the second chakra, to the third chakra, which is solar plexus, emotional body center, to the heart chakra, to the throat chakra, mm-hmm. and then to the brow and crown chakras. And when we get to the brow and crown chakras, or the sixth and seventh chakras, then we're functioning from our spiritual high self. Mm-hmm. And as we function from that spiritual self, we are functioning from our intuitive self. And we can get information. And that's what the lady did who stood up, who had cancer so severely, and stood up in Dr. Sheely's workshop and thanked everyone and went home mm-hmm. and forgave her husband and went on with her life. And she said to herself, I don't care what anyone else thinks. I don't care what anyone... I'm going to live my life with my husband and be happy.
All right. So she opens the channel.
Yes.
And began that process of cleansing, and it began to flow through her entire being.
That's correct. That's correct. And she was functioning from her higher chakra centers, her sixth and seventh chakra centers. And she consciously was doing that because she had learned at the workshop what she had been doing wrong. She had learned that she was sending her energy out caring about what other people thought, being unforgiving toward her husband, and not comfortable within herself, thinking she should do things differently. So she came to terms with her problem, which was whatever her husband chose to do, he'd been doing all his life, so she's not going to change him. He has to change himself. So she forgave him and released that energy. Her friends were well-meaning, she realized, and they were telling her what they thought she should do, but they were not living her life. So she released them from any interference. And she cared. She said, I love my husband. I want to stay with him. So that was her self-image was. She wanted to stay with her husband, so she made the choice. This is what she was going to do. So instead of sending her energy out in all different directions of indecision, she was decisive. Mm-hmm. She sent her energy to her spiritual centers, and in that way, then, she was healed.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. So it brought balance to her.
Exactly.
Yeah.
Exactly.
And she made a decision. That's right. Important, too. She made a decision.
That's correct. Mm-hmm. And we know that through God, all things are possible. And just putting our faith in God instead of in other people is taking a great step forward, mm-hmm. a very great step.
And she, of course, did that. But so often it takes some terrible event in our lives to bring us to that point, although she was brought to that point of decision by simply being surrounded by people who supported her and shared with her these ideas and concepts.
Yes, but I'd like to say one last thing that, according to Dr. Mace, and I believe it to be true, that there are people who take on the karma of the world, and they're ill, and they have problems in their physical bodies because they are being used from the inner planes of being to transmit energy to the world. They're like a sounding board or a receiving station. And we could never judge other people and shouldn't on why anyone else is sick. We could only judge ourselves.
Very, very important idea and concept. And Reverend Freelander and I have been sharing with you some ideas about spiritual healing, and we hope that you found this information useful and look forward to seeing you next time. From where